Okay, let us start now. There are some questions which I received day before yesterday, so I'll try to quickly answer some of them. One question is about a particle under motion behaves like a wave, which is quite obvious. However, I do not know accurately what is psi. That I have anyway discussed day before yesterday, where I said psi is to be treated as somewhat abstract way. It's a probability wave which is happening in a complex system. Unfortunately, that's the best that we can do. So, in that sense, like a normal wave about which you can sort of say what is getting displaced is only the probability which is sort of oscillating, if you want to call it like that. Electromagnetic waves travel with this velocity of light. My question is that there is any possibility of superposition of two waves having two different wavelengths? Of course, there is a possibility of superposition. I mean, the phenomenon of beats is exactly the same thing, where two waves superimpose which have slightly different wavelength. So, things that the superposition principle essentially means that if you have n number of waves, let's say y1, y2, y3 up till yn, the total displacement is just sum of y1 plus y2 plus y3 plus yn. So, see, whatever number of the waves are there, you have to just simply go and keep on adding mathematically, that's what you are going to get. So, there's a superposition is definitely valid for them. Now, for quantization of energy level, only boundary conditions are required. Is normalization condition required for quantization of energy levels? No, normalization is just to normalize the probability. In fact, even if you would not have normalized the wave function, the energy levels would have been same. Okay, the only thing is that when you are actually looking at the probabilities, in that case, if I have not normalized, they will only give you the relative probability, they will not give you the absolute probability. So, if you want to find out the absolute probability of finding particle, let's say between x and x plus dx, then you have to use normalized wave function. That's the only difference. How did we obtain the general solution of a particle in a rigid body box? Of course, this little bit I will discuss today. I mean, this becomes more of a sort of a differential equation problem. But, you know, they are sort of two standard type of differential equation which we always use in physics. And most of the time, just by looking at those equations, I'll be able to find out what is the solution of it. So, this I will explain a little bit in today's lecture when I'm doing some of the problems. Then I have two questions. Instead of using identical system, what would happen if we take repeated readings on the same system, provided we ensure that the system returns to the original state? See, that's what is the tricky question. Now, how do we ensure that the system returns to the original state? Of course, if it returns to the original state, whatever I have said earlier will be true. But what I am trying to say that once we have made the measurement, it's no longer in the original state. Okay, so things get changed, and after that, you know, repeated measurements will give values according to the new wave function and not according to the old wave function. If at all it's possible to regenerate the system to the old wave function, then whatever we are saying earlier would be true. If n increases to infinity, what will happen to behavior of wave function? Of course, you know, when n tends to infinity, it depends again on the system. But, you know, for a very large value of energy, you can show that this will approximately be equal to the classical system. You know, when you have very large energies, you know, in principle, it should be behaving like classical system. Then there is a question, if there are 5 electrons in the ground state, what will be their energy? Of course, you cannot have 5 electrons in the ground state because electrons obey Pauli exclusion principle. I think when Professor Suresh is going to talk about solid state physics, he's going to talk about these things. Okay, in principle, if whatever the states that we are getting as a result of solution of Schrodinger equation, okay, in principle, not more than 2 electrons can occupy that state. And 2 we say because, you know, there is spin which we have not accommodated in the normal quantum mechanics. If we accommodate spin also, then there are 2 possible states of spin up and spin down. So, therefore, each state which we evaluate from Schrodinger equation can in principle be occupied maximum by 2 electrons, one with spin up and another with spin down. So, there is no question that there are 5 electrons which can occupy these states. Of course, if these happens to be bosons, which again I think probably Dr. Suresh may discuss a little bit, only in that case it's possible that 5 of the particles will occupy all the ground state. In that case, this problem is of a statistics. I mean, we have discussed Maxwell-Boltzmann statistics. You have to go to more refined statistics when you are talking about quantum systems, which we call as a Fermi-Dirac statistics, when particles obey Pauli exclusion principle, and Bose-Einstein statistics, when particles do not obey Pauli exclusion principle. So, that becomes more of a part of statistical mechanics. Then another question is that in a double slit experiment using electrons, we consider electron wave moving with velocity of light or with velocity less than c. No. I mean, this I think we have discussed a number of times that the electron wave has to travel with the same speed as the electron, and the electron will travel with whatever energy we have given. So, when I have accelerated the electrons are emitted, they would have a particular amount of kinetic energy, and whatever is the kinetic energy corresponding to that, the electrons would have a speed, and that is the speed which will remain, and the wave group also has to travel with the same speed. So, there is no question, of course, you know, particle wave can never travel. In fact, yesterday I had, all, not yesterday, but day before yesterday, I had also explained that what can travel with larger than c is only the phase speed. That also, if we define frequency in a particular way, but you know, that is of purely mathematical consequence. You know, there is nothing physical about that. Okay, then there is another question which is an interesting question. Instead of one particle in one dimensional potential well, if you introduce two particles like electron, electron, or proton, proton, or neutron, neutron, what are the energy eigenvalues and eigenfunctions? Of course, this is an interesting question. In principle, when you are taking, if you are taking, for example, charged particles, you have to also accommodate for the forces which are there between the charged particles. The potential energy becomes much more complicated. But, you know, as we normally do in the case of solids, which Professor Suresh will do, okay, you always, as a first approximation, you assume that even though the particles are interacting, they are charged and there is force between them, we neglect that and we assume that the electrons or the particles are experiencing only the force because of the Coulomb interaction of the solid, and assuming that, you know, the energy states do not change. And we can then talk about statistics and find out how they are going to be occupied. But if you want to solve the problem exactly when you have more than one particular particles, you have to also take interparticle forces into consideration when you are talking of the total potential energy. The another question is that in slit, a single slit experiment, is not the wall stopping the electrons? Of course, you know, if there is a wall, that will stop the electrons, so there is nothing very surprising about that. Is it necessary that along every wave function should there be a constant? That I have seen, that I have told you that the nature of the Schrodinger equation is like that. If psi is a solution, A psi will always be a solution. You can substitute there and see, because A eventually will cancel out when I substitute A psi. So there is always an A which will always be present, which, as I said, has to be found from normalization condition. The next question is that what do you mean by dynamical variable? By dynamical variable, which I mean any variable which defines anything related to dynamics. For example, it could be just displacement, it could be velocity, it could be acceleration, okay, it could be angular momentum, it could be whatever you want to solve. Talk of x square, talk of x cube, all those things. Does E mean the total energy or the kinetic energy? In this case of Schrodinger equation, E always represents the total non-relativistic energy. Okay, because when we come to relativity, we also talk that energy E is also defined in a slightly different fashion by Einstein, which is, for example, the standard well-known relationship E is equal to mc square. But that energy E doesn't have any classical analog. In Schrodinger equation, when we talk about E, that E is always the classical energy, which can always be taken as potential energy plus kinetic energy. Only thing in the case of particle in a box, because the potential energy is zero, so E happens to be only the kinetic energy. The next question is that we can calculate the energies of the by using one-dimensional box. Can we compare these energies with Bohr model of energy levels? No, Bohr model is totally different, because in Bohr model, the potential energy is not just constant, but it's given by your Coulombian interaction E square about 4 pi epsilon naught r. That particular problem has to be solved in a totally different fashion. Okay, so the solution of hydrogen atom in its completeness, is quite long. I'm sure all of you would have done MSc in physics, you know, would have undergone that particular thing, which is fairly long, and that's, of course, beyond the scope of this particular course. But if you look at any book on quantum mechanics, they will always solve the energy corresponding to a hydrogen atom, and those energies do turn out to be equal to the Bohr's energy. That was actually the success of quantum mechanics, that, you know, when quantum mechanics was being developed, that, see, we know that energies that were found by Bohr, okay, are able to explain the atomic spectra, and therefore people had faith in Bohr's theory. And then we realized that Bohr's theory does not always work, and then, you know, but the energy seemed to be working. And what was the success of quantum mechanics originally? That one could get exactly the same energies as Bohr had obtained. Bohr had obtained by some sort of phenomenology, while this is actually by solution of Schrodinger equation. Okay, those derivations of those energies are much more complex, and obviously has nothing to do with the particle in a box. What is the effect observed on wave function energy of the particle in a box with different boundary values? In fact, it's a very interesting problem. One can always work it out from x is equal to minus L to x is equal to plus L, or minus L by 2 to plus L by 2. You will always get the same values of energy, provided you take the appropriate length of the box. Okay, the boundary conditions become somewhat different. In fact, it's a good exercise to work out this particular problem, assuming that the origin is not at 0, but origin is at half of the box. Okay, then you have to apply boundary conditions which are much more symmetrical, and still you will get exactly the same same wave function and the same values of energy. That does not cause a problem. There are a lot of questions which ask for what is the justification and what are the physical significance. These are very, very difficult questions. Okay, I mean, we have discussed that in quantum mechanics, we cannot treat everything in a classical way. In classical mechanics, we can ask a lot of questions about, you know, how the particle moves, okay, how it goes from one point, particular point to another point. While in quantum mechanics, many of these things are, you know, somewhat hidden in uncertainty principle. Many of the questions we cannot answer exactly the same way that we can sort of ask in a classical mechanics problem. So things cannot be justified in a simple fashion. I mean, let me put it like that. I would like to say that quantum mechanics is itself a theory, and whatever you obtain from quantum mechanics is essentially an outcome of the solution of that particular equation. So, see, like for example, when we try to explain the normal motion, we always take this stand, okay, that we obtain this from Newton's law of motion, because Newton's law of motion is my original theory, and whatever I got it from, I can explain a particular behavior on the basis of Newton's laws of motion. Similarly, we can argue in this particular case that, okay, my Schrodinger equation or basic quantum mechanics is the original theory, and whatever is the justification that I have to give has to be given only on the basis of Schrodinger equation. I do not have any independent justification. Okay. Similarly, you know, just like for a classical particle, our justification lies in Newton's law of motion. I am not giving any other justification. So that becomes my original theory, original model from which I derive all those things. Similarly, here Schrodinger equation becomes my original equation, and the only way to justify all these things is using Schrodinger equation. Then what is the justification to derive Schrodinger equation? I have a time-dependent equation using time-independent equation. In fact, it's the other way. We obtain time-independent Schrodinger equation from time-dependent Schrodinger equation, and that's by just mathematically separating the variable, which is the very standard technique in differential equations. So I don't think we can give any specific justification for that particular thing. What is the significance of finding the expectation value? That's what I have said. There is no significance other than that you are interested in finding out the average value of certain quantity because of whatever reason you want. For example, I used uncertainty principle. For that, I obtained the value of x square, which is expected value of a square. I obtained the expected value of x. Okay. So there cannot be any specific significance other than that because of some reason, I need that particular value. I may like to ask a question, what is the average value of the position when I make, you know, let's say, very large number of measurements on the position of a particle. So if I am interested in that, then I will obtain, this is the way to obtain it. So there is no other justification that we can give, or there is no significance that we can attach. It's the significance as, for example, if I have to calculate the average mark of the entire class, so that's the justification that I am interested in finding out the average mark of the class just to get how has been the performance of the students. Similarly, I may be interested in finding out what is the average position of the particle if I make a very large number of particles. If I am interested, that's what is the significance. There is nothing else that we can say about that. And the last question is that zero rest mass is called massive. In fact, that's not correct. In fact, zero rest mass we have not been calling massive. When I say massive particles, it means a particle which does not have a zero rest mass. A particle with rest mass non-zero, that's what I have called as a massive particle. Zero rest mass particle is called, is it because, so I am never calling zero rest particle as a massive particle. So, when we do relativity, we will see that massive particle and a particle with zero rest mass are treated exactly by the same equations. So, other than that, the fact that m0 is equal to 0, that one has to substitute in certain expressions. Otherwise, we use exactly the same basic equations as we use for a particle with m0 is equal to 0 and for a particle with m0 not equal to 0. Okay, this sort of gives us the idea of the questions which I had got it. Now, let's come back to the lectures. So, we recapitulate of what we did day before yesterday. We talked about the orthonormality of wave functions, and then we talked about the non-stationary states. We introduced many new concepts. We introduced the concept of collapse of wave function. We introduced the concept of eigenvalues and eigenfunctions. And using all those things, we eventually gave some of the postulates of quantum mechanics. Some of these things we'll be using as we keep on, we have another, today and then in the afternoon. We have two lectures in which I'll be covering basically the formal part of quantum mechanics. We'll have one more session which will be more on problems and quantum mechanics, and then we'll move to crystallography and then eventually to special theory of relativity. Okay. Now, let's go a little bit ahead and try to make my problems slightly more realistic. Earlier, I have solved a particular problem in which the particle was contained in what I call as infinite potential well, or many times it's called infinite square well potential. Now, I will call it finite square well potential. So, the difference between the earlier problem and the problem that I am going to discuss now is that in the earlier problem, V was infinite when I am going between for values of x less than 0 and for values of x greater than L. Now the potential is not infinite, but the potential is finite. V is equal to V naught here, and we have V is equal to V naught here. And so only within this particular box between x is equal to 0 and x is equal to L, that potential energy V is 0. So this is what I have said is the condition of potential energy. Vx is equal to 0 for values of x between 0 and L, and is equal to V naught whenever x is less than 0 and whenever x greater than L. So you would always say that this is somewhat more realistic, okay, but we will see that just by making it little more realistic, the problem has become much more difficult. Okay, and in fact, we will not be able to find out the energy values in this particular case in a very, very straightforward, in a sort of closed manner. We will not be able to find out an expression the way we have obtained for a particle in an infinite square potential well. Okay, but nevertheless, this particular problem is very, very illustrative because it gives you the way we apply boundary conditions in a more generic fashion. Okay, and also introduces some new ideas. Now, first thing that I would like to mention here is that when I am solving this particular problem, I am assuming that the energy of the particular particle is less than V naught. It means the particle has energy somewhere here, because that's the only way this particular particle will be confined in this particular potential well. See, whenever we have situation like this, we call these particular problems as a bound state problem. So this is a bound state problem because the particle is supposed to be bound in this particular region, even though, as we will be seeing, that there is a small amount of probability that the particle could be found outside this particular box. That is what happens in the case of quantum mechanics. This particular aspect we will discuss little bit more in this particular case. So this problem is little more interesting than the earlier problem, which, as I say, was the simplest problem in quantum mechanics that we had worked it out. Okay, so this is the thing, and whenever we have discontinuity of potentials, which we are still maintaining here, so I have said that is not really realistic. In a real situation, you generally do not have discontinuity of potential energies. But let us assume that as a value of x, we have discontinuity of potential energy. We always divide this particular problem into various regions. This is what I have done. Region 1, this I am calling as R1. This is region 2, which I am calling as R2. And this is region 3, which I am calling as R3. So my R1, my potential energy is V is equal to V naught. And R2, my potential energy is V is equal to 0. And in R3, my potential energy is equal to V is equal to V naught again. Again, I repeat, my E is less than V naught. So my particle is bound in this particular case. If my E happens to be larger than V naught, then this becomes what we call as a free state problem. And immediately after this problem, I will start discussing free state problems, and that are slightly of different type. As you will see, that the way we apply boundary conditions are in a slightly different fashion in those cases, and the way we interpret wave functions is also somewhat different fashions. But at this moment, let us just consider this particular problem. Now, what happens? Because there are discontinuity of potential energies here, we always try to solve independently the Schrödinger equation in this region, and in the third region. So we first solve the Schrödinger equation in this particular case, and then eventually write the general equations, general solutions of the equation in all the three regions, region 1, 2 and 3, and then eventually we apply the boundary conditions. That is what is the most important aspect in quantum mechanics, the boundary conditions that we imply, that keeping physics in mind, we have to, or keeping postulates of quantum mechanics in mind, we apply appropriate boundary conditions, and then we will be able to see how do we eventually could obtain the energy of the particles which is confined in this particular box. Okay. Now, let us write these equations, which I am writing in the next transparency, in these three regions separately. So this is my region 1. So this is my d2 phi dx square. Remember, this is the Schrödinger equation, plus 2m upon h square e minus v naught psi 1x. Alright. So this is exactly the Schrödinger equation. The only difference here is that this I am writing as phi 1. So I am saying that this is a solution which is valid only for R1, region 1. In the second region, which is actually the region of the box, potential energy is 0. So this V naught has been put 0, but this particular wave function or this particular equation is valid only for region 2. So I am writing psi phi 2 here. So this is phi 2. This was region 1, this was region 2. So phi 1, phi 2. Now in region 3, again my potential energy goes back to V naught. So again we write exactly the same equation which is here, but here I am writing phi 3 because this is the wave function which will be valid only in region 3. Okay. So at the moment, I have written only the equations. I have to solve these equations. Only thing when I solve, I have to realize this particular fact that in this particular case, my E is supposed to be less than V naught, because as I have said earlier, that I am assuming that my particle is bound here. So, energy has to be lower than V naught. If it is larger than V naught, then this particular particle, this potential energy, I mean this particular particle is essentially what we call as a free particle, which is not a bound particle. Here the particle is bound. So, essentially if, or in the other words, if I look classically, if I look classically, only when the energy of the particle is less than V naught, the particle will be confined within the box. Okay. Otherwise, if E is larger than V naught, this particle is free to move outside the box. So, if this particular particle has to be confined in the box in a classical sense, then E has to be less than V naught. Okay. So, if I compare, for example, with the classical mechanics, I can get an idea that this particular particle will actually be called a bound particle, because this is not existing, I mean it is not possible for it to exist, I mean in the entire region of this space. Okay. This particular part of being free state and bound state, I will explain a little later. So, what will happen here, this particular quantity will be negative of particular thing. So, actually what I will prefer to write, I will rather prefer to write this as V naught minus E and put a negative sign here. When I put a negative sign here, because normally I would like to always handle with real numbers and numbers which are positive. So, I will rewrite this equation as V naught minus E and then substitute it here. Now, that as I have said that people have been asking this question. So, these are the two type of questions that we generally write here. See, if we have written this equation, let us write d2, general equations, differential equation d2 y dx square. It could be, let us say, k square y or d2 y dx square is equal to minus k square y. So, I am putting k square just to say that this particular quantity is actually positive. So, if we have equation of the type d2 y dx square is equal to k square y, and we have equation d2 y dx square is equal to minus k square y, generally by look we can write the solution. In this case, see, remember this is second order differential equation. So, there have to be two unknowns. Whenever I have a negative sign, generally I prefer to write this equation as a sine kx plus b cos kx. And you can see that if I substitute this equation in this particular thing, this will solve. If I differentiate y with respect to x, I will get a k cos kx, and this I will get minus b k sin kx. If I write d 2 y d k square, I have to differentiate it further once more. So, this cosine will become now sine, but with a negative sign. So, this will become minus k square sin kx, and there is already minus sign, but when you differentiate sine, you get only plus. So, you get minus b k square sin kx. So, this you get as minus k square, then a sin kx plus b sin kx, I can write as y. So, you can see that this equation is a solution of this equation. On the other hand, if I take k square y, then I write this general solution in the form of y dx square is equal to a e raise to power kx plus b e raise to power minus kx. Sorry, what I am doing, I am writing y like this. So, I differentiate dy dx, I differentiate this with respect to x. So, I will get a k e raise power a k x minus b k e raise power minus k x. I differentiate once more with respect to x. So, I will get another k out here. So, I will get a k square e raise power k x. I differentiate again. So, I will get b k square e raise power minus k x. So, you will get k square into y. So, as we see that if this particular term happens to be positive, now we write the general solution in the form of exponential. On the other hand, if this is negative, then we write generally in terms of the sinusoidal functions. And you should realize that the nature of sinusoidal function and the exponential function is different. Sinusoidal functions are sine functions and cosine functions are oscillatory function, while these functions which we are talking about exponential functions here, these are with respect to x, there is no oscillation, either it will go to plus infinity or it will go to minus infinity depending upon the sign here. So the nature of the two relationships are different. Of course, you can always say that I can always imagine k to be imaginary, then can't I write the general solution also in that particular form? Of course, you can also write in this case, if you want the solution to be in the form of y is equal to a e raise power I kx plus b e raise power minus I kx. This is what I will be using whenever I am doing for the free state problem. Here in this case, it does not matter for a particle in a box. Even if you have tried a wave function of this particular type, which is correct, you would have got exactly the same answer. Nothing would have changed. Okay, it's just because we are a little more familiar with the sine term, and as far as possible, we may not like to have used, I mean, it's not always possible. So, but you know, if we can avoid use of imaginary numbers, you know, it's somewhat simpler. Let me put it like that, it's a matter of choice which you want to do it. In this particular case, when your equation is of this type, whether you write phi like this or whether you write like this, it does not make a difference like this. Of course, you can also say, in this case also, can't I write this solution in terms of sine? But then it will be sine of imaginary number, then it will become hyperbolic functions. So in that case, again the equations have to be looked into different fashion. Again, we are not very familiar with hyperbolic functions, at least the students at the first year level are not so much familiar. So generally what I have told that either when I am having equation of this particular type, either I use sine kx plus cos kx or as this, okay, whichever is more convenient. Okay, in the case of bound state problem, many times I write like this being more convenient. But in the case of free state problem, I am obliged to write in this particular fashion, as I will be discussing little later. On the other hand, when I have equation of this particular type, I always prefer to write in terms of kx and minus kx. And also because these are not oscillatory functions, many times I avoid using k. In fact, this instead of k, I use alpha square. So I will always write this as alpha square, and here I will write as alpha. And here also I will write as alpha. So this is just a matter of how you sort of represent. So there is it depends again on, as I said, in a matter of choice. This is the way when I look at these equations, I can find out sort of solution. So as you can see, if I look at this particular equation, because E minus V naught is negative, so this will be negative sign. So this equation will be of the form d2y dx square is equal to alpha square phi 1. While this equation, because this particular quantity is positive, so when I take it to the right hand side, this equation will be of the form d2 phi dx square is equal to minus k square phi, while this equation will be again of this particular form. So therefore, now I am in a position to write the general equations in this particular form. That is what I have written. Note the sign of the quantity in a square bracket for different regions. The functional behavior would depend on this. For phi 1, I have written a e raise power alpha x, and remember when I have defined alpha square, I have defined this as 2m V naught minus E, because remember it is this quantity which is going to be positive, because V naught is going to be greater than E. So this alpha has to be positive. So this alpha number here, which is coming here, is going to be a real number. And A e raised power alpha x with real x is an exponentially growing function, while this is an exponentially decaying function. Now in region 2, because my equation nature was slightly different, so I wrote general solution as C sine kx plus D cos kx, and my k square was defined as 2me upon h square. Again, if you have some doubts, you can substitute these solutions back into the equation which I have written on the last transparencies, and you can convince yourself that this is going to be the value of alpha square, this is going to be the value of k square. Now, similarly in region 3, I can write the solution only in this particular form. So this is what I have written. Alpha turns out to be exactly same, because the potential energy in region 1 and region 3 are same. So alphas are same. Remember, I am taking the constants to be different, because these constants in general have to be found out from the boundary conditions, and in this case, in principle, their values could be very different. So I am writing the most general solution in the three regions. As you can very clearly appreciate, there are going to be six constants A, B, C, D, F and G. Okay. Now let's start looking into the boundary conditions. Let's go back to this particular figure of this thing. See, remember when we had particle in a box problem, infinite box problem, which we worked out earlier. In that case, the only condition that I had applied was that the wave function should be continuous. At that time, we had argued that the wave function here is going to be 0, the wave function here is going to be 0. So all that you wanted, that the wave function should disappear at x is equal to 0 and should disappear at x is equal to L. The wave function should be 0 at the two ends. All right. But we have mentioned when we are talking about the postulates of quantum mechanics that matching wave function is always true. But in general, derivative of the wave function should also match, and we said that unless V is equal to, there is an infinite jump in potential energy, we need not we should always match the derivatives. In that particular problem that we did earlier, v was equal to infinite. So at x is equal to 0 and at x is equal to L, there was an infinite jump in the potential. So we did not match the derivative of the wave function. We only match phi, we did not match d phi dx. But in this case, because this jump is only finite, this is v naught is assumed to be finite. In this case, then I have to match their derivatives also. So I have to match not only phi in this particular end, from solution of this particular end, solution of this particular end, at this particular point at x is equal to 0, not only their individual value should match, but their derivatives should also match. So this will give me two equations. Similarly, when I match the wave function between region 2 and region 3 and their derivatives, then I will get two more equations, then I am getting four more equations. Now what is happening? I have six constants, I get only four equations. Of course, there is one particular constant which I can never get rid of, that is, has to be found from normalization condition. Okay, how do I eliminate other constants in order to find out the general solution? That's what is interesting, and that's way we have to apply the boundary conditions. Okay, the condition that now I am going to apply in order to get rid of some constants is again that wave function must be well behaved. When we had talked about the wave function being well behaved, we had said that wave function should be continuous, it should be single valued, and it should always be finite. This is what we have said. We also applied the condition on d phi dx to be continuous. All right. Now, if you look at the solution of region 1, remember region 1 extends from minus infinity to x is equal to 0. So, it extends only for negative values of x. This solution of region 1 is not valid for x is equal to x greater than 0 or for positive values of x. Between x is equal to 0 and L, phi 2 is the valid solution. For x greater than L, phi 3 is the valid solution. So, let us first look at the solution R1, which is valid only for negative values of x. The solution in R3 is valid only for values of x greater than L. So, this was my solution. Remember, just now I said that this relationship is valid only for negative values of x. If I put x is equal to minus infinity, remember I cannot put plus infinity here because this is not valid for positive values of x. So, if I put x is equal to minus infinity, this term will become 0. Okay, no problem. This will remain finite. For all negative values of x, this term will always remain finite. But what happens about this particular term? If I put x is equal to minus infinity, if I keep on increasing negative values of x, you will find that this particular term will keep on blowing up. And as x tends to infinity, this particular x tends to minus infinity, this term will actually blow up to infinite. And as I expect that wave function should always be finite, this particular term cannot be allowed into the wave function. So, I force this particular term to become 0, or in other words, I put b is equal to 0. So, if I put b is equal to 0, then only this particular term is present. So, you are able to get rid of this particular term purely from the condition that wave function must always be finite. Now, as far as region 2 is concerned, no issues, because region 2, you know, is only between 0 and L, and between 0 and L, this value is always going to remain finite. Moreover, sine and cosine are always oscillatory function, they will never become infinite. Even if this particular solution would have been valid at x is equal to plus infinity or minus infinity, which it is not, even then sine and cosine will always be oscillating between plus 1 and minus 1. They could never blow to infinity. Same thing is not true for exponential function. Now, let us come to region 3. Now, region 3 is valid for all values of x greater than L. Okay, it means it is also valid as x tends to plus infinity. When x tends to plus infinity, this term will tend to 0, because when you put infinity, you know, this is e to the power minus infinity, so this term will tend to 0. So, for all values of x greater than L, this term will be finite. But as far as this term is concerned, as x tends to infinity, this term will blow up, and therefore, I do not want this term, because I want the wave function to be always finite. So, what I will get, I will put this g equal to 0, I will not be able to allow this particular thing. So, what we have seen, that I would have got four equations from matching the wave functions and their derivatives. Now, I am also able to get rid of two other constants. I mean, I have got six equations essentially, okay, and there is another equation, which is the normalization condition. We have always one equation in excess of how many number of constants we have. In this case, the energy will turn out to be quantized. That initial condition will always try to normalize, to will be responsible for quantization of the energy. So this is what I have said. We put B is equal to 0 and G is equal to 0. So I have put B is equal to 0 and G is equal to 0 here. This is what I have done. So my equations now become this. My solutions become only this. This is valid for region 1, this is valid for region 2, this is valid for region 3. So I have got rid of the other term. Here also I have got rid of other term, ensuring that phi 1 always remains finite and phi 3 always remains finite. Now I will match their values. I will put first boundary is between region 1 and region 2, which occurs at x is equal to 0. So phi 1 at x is equal to 0 must be equal to phi 2 at x is equal to 0. Similarly, I will match another boundary condition at boundary between region 2 and region 3, which occurs at x is equal to L. So I will put at x is equal to L what the wave function should be continuous. Then I also want their derivatives to be constant. So first I will take differentiate this particular thing with respect to x. Remember, first we have to differentiate, then put the value of x. So we differentiate and then put x is equal to 0 and then match their derivatives. Similarly, between here and here, I will differentiate this with respect to x, differentiate this with respect to x, put x is equal to L here, then equate the two. So this is what I am doing in the next transparency. So this is a boundary between region 1 and region 2. So I have put phi 1 at x is equal to 0 to phi 2 equal to be 0. There was only e raised power alpha x, e raised power alpha x. So I am putting x is equal to 0, so this becomes just a. So e a e raised power 0, so this becomes a. Sin 0 is anyway 0, cos 0 is 1, so this gives you a is equal to d. Then I take the derivative, first I differentiate. If I differentiate this term, I will get a alpha e raised power alpha x. Put x is equal to 0, so I will get only a times alpha, because e raised power 0 will be 1. So a alpha e raised power 0. Then I differentiate. When I differentiate, sine becomes cosine and a k term will come out. So it will be ck cos kx, and put x is equal to 0, so it becomes ck cos 0. When I differentiate cos, I will get a negative sign. So I will get minus dk sin kx. Okay, I put x is equal to 0, so this becomes sin is equal to 0. This term now will become 0, so I will get a alpha is equal to ck. So this is the boundary condition which has been applied between region 1 and region 2. Now I will rather go quickly because pure mathematics. Between region 2 and region 3, I will apply the boundary conditions, okay, between phi 2 and phi 3, because this is the wave function which is valid in region 2. This is the wave function which is valid in region 3. Okay, I just put the values of L here. I just put the value of L after differentiating here. So these are the boundary conditions that I have applied. Now what I will try to do is to solve them. And normally what I try to do, try to solve in with respect to A, I take one constant because I know my equation is such that I will never be able to get rid of one particular constant. So let's choose that particular constant to be A. So express all other constants in terms of A and let this A be found out by normalization at a later point. So these are my conditions, four conditions, A is equal to D, A alpha is equal to CK, and these are little more complicated conditions. So what I will do, I will find out F. D I have already found in terms of A. C is also very clearly C is equal to alpha upon K. Alpha upon K times A. So what I will do, I will put C and D in terms of A. Then I will get two equations and both the equations will contain only A. Okay. Then in order that the equations are consistent, I will divide the two equations and then A will cancel out. Then I will get one particular equation which is independent of any constant, and that's the equation which must get satisfied if all the boundary conditions should be satisfied and the wave function should be well behaved. So this is what I am doing. Express all constants in terms of A. So I have put D is equal to A, C is equal to alpha by KA. Then other equation I have put this C as alpha upon K, D I have put as A. There also there was a C which I have put as alpha upon K. The D I have put as minus A. These are the equations. There is F here. See, you look at this equation. On the left hand side there is A, the right hand side there is F. Here there is A, there is F. If I divide these two equations, in that particular case what you will find, the A will cancel out. Remember, A cannot be 0. F will cancel out. When both cancels out, you will get a purely an equation which does not have any constants. This equation is the one equation which must get satisfied if all boundary conditions are satisfied and if wave function is well behaved. This equation is the one which is going to give rise to energies. So this is what I am calling as energy eigenvalues. I think now we can use the term eigenvalues, that because these are eigenvalues of the Hamiltonian operator. So divide the last two equations. This is what you are going to get. Remember, alpha I had defined as h cross alpha under root 2m v naught minus e, and k I have defined as h cross k under root 2m e. All right. So basically K and alpha both depend on energy. Alpha also depends on what is the potential energy in for negative values of x and for values of x greater than L. So depending upon what is the value of V naught, this is, happens to be a complicated transcendental equation. If you can solve this equation, or these days with the computers, it's quite easy to solve it. Otherwise, people were using earlier graphical method to solve these equations. Okay, you can find out what will be the values of energy for which this particular condition is going to be satisfied. It will get satisfied only for certain specific values of energy, and those will be the only values of energy that will be allowed in the system. So this is what we will be calling that energy is again quantized, but I am not able to find out this energy in a closed form as I was able to find out for a particle in an infinite potential well. Here, these, to find out the energy values, you must solve this equation. All I am trying to say that this equation is given a particular value of L. This equation is going to be satisfied only for some specific values of energies, and those will be the values of energy that will be allowed for this particular particle. So energy will turn out to be quantized. Now, there is another interesting question here, which is what we call as a classically forbidden region. When I call this particular bound particle, I say classically this particular particle which has an energy E less than V naught can never leak out to this particular area in region 1 and region 3. Because if at all it leaks out, its potential energy is larger than its total energy, it means its kinetic energy will turn out to be negative. And in classical mechanics, negative kinetic energy does not mean anything. A particle cannot have a negative kinetic energy. It means velocity is imaginary. A velocity, imaginary velocity does not mean anything. A quantity which is real, a physical quantity which is velocity, velocity cannot take a imaginary value. Therefore, this is what I call as a classically forbidden region. Classically forbidden region are these regions where classically the particle could not have been found, because in that case, kinetic energy would turn out to be negative. But now we see that the wave function exists here. Here is an exponentially decaying function. Here also it's exponentially decaying function. But on the other hand, it has its presence. It means if it has its presence, okay, there is a finite probability of finding the particle in what we call as a classically forbidden region. So in principle, it's possible for the particle to be present in what we call as a classically forbidden region. Okay. Now you can always ask the question if it is. I mean, okay, let me first say that had this been a wave, then probably you can understand, because there is always a skin depth through which the penetrates. But in a pure classical particle sense, okay, it's very surprising, I mean, that a particle could exist in what is a classically forbidden region. But you should understand that in quantum mechanics, okay, particle is not really the classical particle. This particular particle has a wave character. Okay. In fact, we have discussed earlier quite clearly that if you have a picture of a particle which is a localized entity, that's not going to work when you're talking of quantum mechanical particles in these type of systems. Okay. And we have said that this sort of somewhat mysterious. On the other hand, if you really want to insist on particle picture and say that I would like to localize this particular particle and really try to measure, it's almost as we are trying to determine from which particular particle, from which particular slit the electron went in the double slit experiment. Whenever I perform this experiment, I want to localize this particular particle into the classically forbidden region and measure its kinetic energy to find out whether it's really turning out to be negative. Okay, I will create enough perturbation into the system that this particular particle will no longer be in a classically forbidden region. This can of course be shown through a particular problem, which I'm not sure if we have time, we will probably do it. But basically, that's what is the idea, that if we take a pure wave picture, then you know that a wave, even if there is a particular, let's say, sheet of paper or a sheet of a material which is completely opaque to light, light nevertheless penetrates to some extent inside this particular medium, okay, which we call as a skin depth. So if we look at the wave nature, then I can understand that this particular particle wave has a small amount of penetration, okay. But if you look at purely classical nature of the particle, then I will not be able to understand it. Again, it's not always possible to mix up classical ideas of particle with wave mechanical picture. So we say that there is a non-zero probability of finding the particle in the classically forbidden region. This probability decreases exponentially as we move away from the box. Remember, this we still call the localized particle, because probability of the particle decays as we go out of the box. So this particular particle is still called a localized particle. However, the uncertainty principle prohibits one to localize the particle in that region and measure its kinetic energy and really show that this is negative, and then what will happen to its velocity? You will not be able to perform this experiment. From wave nature, we can understand the finite penetration in the form of skin depth, as just now I have mentioned. Now, if at all I want to normalize, I have expressed all the constants in terms of A. So this becomes my equation. This was my wave function in the region 1. This was my wave function in region 2. I have to square it. This was my wave function in region 3. Then I have to integrate, take psi star psi, integrate and put this equal to 1. That will give me the value of A finally, which is the final value of A that one has to obtain to make the wave function complete, okay, if at all we want to normalize it. And as you can see, that this particular solution itself is going to be fairly complex if I want to find out the value of A. Just by making the problem little more realistic, my mathematics has become much more complex. Remember, quantum mechanics is a highly mathematical subject. I mean, a lot of people have been asking question, what is the need of doing quantum mechanics? The thing is that there are so many things, so many wonderful things in the nature, or so many, I mean, even the form of devices that you cannot understand. For example, you just simply cannot understand how a semiconductor device will work. I mean, semiconductor devices, so much of spread of semiconductor devices everywhere, you know, you are using semiconductor devices, okay. Now, you cannot understand the way they work unless you know quantum mechanics. So many parts of the sciences where quantum mechanics is inherent. Remember, whenever we have to describe for anything where I want to talk of a particle at a microscopic level, I need quantum mechanics. If you are talking of recording, magnetic recording, people are using magnetic recording there, the whole area of spintronics which has come. I mean, in fact, people call that this is for the first time that we have been able to find out quantum mechanical heads, which are used for reading information from, let's say, hard disk of your magnetic computers. Quantum mechanics is necessary to understand. You will not be able to understand how these devices work. Forget about, you know, further research and further advancement unless you know quantum mechanics. Okay. Howsoever abstract is the quantum mechanics, okay, it's necessary to understand if you want to understand the working of the devices and want to make those advancements. Now, let's come to a free state problem, which is a slightly different type of problem. These are also very, very interesting type of problems. So, let's just discuss. You will see that the language has become somewhat different. These problems are often used when we call of a scattering. Many times, let's say a beam of particle is coming and they encounter a potential energy and, you know, a step potential as we call it. And because of that, you find that the particle change their path. So, we call them free state because generally you will find that the region where particle can exist with finite probability, that is infinite. So, such type of problems are generally called free state problems. And as I have told earlier, that in these problems, in general, it's not possible to normalize the wave function because the probability, the A will turn out to be zero. But the normalization is not that great amount of interest. Other important thing that we'll discuss in this particular case, that in free state problem, you'll find that energies do not turn out to be quantized. All possible values of energy are possible. There is a continuum of energy which are possible. Only when the particular particle is bound that the energy turns out to be quantized. I think I mentioned even this earlier, that for a bound particle, there are two things which are very, very important. The first thing is that the ground state of the particle, that's the lowest energy state, will not be zero. And the second thing is that the energy levels will be quantized. When you are talking of free state problems, none of these conditions occupy. Okay, all possible values of energies are allowed. Now, let us look at this particular system. Now, we say that there is a particular particle. Of course, we always try to work out with a single particle potential wave functions. Okay, there is a particle which is coming from the left hand side. And let's suppose it comes with the energy E. Okay, now, in all these regions, right from minus infinity to x is equal to 0, the potential energy was 0. It means this particular particle, the energy that it has E was purely kinetic because its potential energy turns out to be 0. So, you have only kinetic energy, a particle which coming with the energy E which is approaching here. Now, let's look at this particular problem classically first. Now, at x is equal to 0, suddenly the particle encounters a potential, I have not got hell, but a step potential, a potential hill. Okay, potential suddenly changes from V is equal to 0 to V is equal to V naught. All right. I mean, in classical mechanics, whenever there is a change of potential energy, there will always be a force. Okay, but let's not bother about this particular thing as of now, because in quantum mechanics, we are talking purely from the point of view of potential energies. Okay. Now, classically, if I look at this particular problem, because I am assuming that this E is greater than V naught, as far as this particular case is concerned, if E is greater than V naught, you will find out that in this region, when the particle goes beyond x is equal to 0, or it goes in positive values of x, its kinetic energy will go down, energy has to be conserved. So, whatever was the value of energy, then E minus V naught will be its kinetic energy. So, the particle which is coming from the left hand side will definitely will be able to go and cross over the x is equal to 0 region and eventually go to x is equal to plus infinity. But now, beyond x is equal to 0, its kinetic energy and hence its velocity will go down. This is what I would have looked at classical way. Now, when I try to solve the problem quantum mechanically, we'll find something interesting, which says that there is also a probability, there's a small amount of probability that this particle which is going this way can come back. Okay? Again, this I can understand if I am doing a wave nature, because in wave nature, whenever there is a change of medium, there is always going to be some reflection. Okay? But on the other hand, purely from particle nature, I will not be able to understand this particular issue. So, I mean, remember, in this case, as I have been always talking, that these particular particles do have a wave character. So, I cannot just think this particular particle is a pure 100% classical particle. Okay, so let's try to solve the problem. We have only two regions here, region 1 and region 2. I will write the Schrodinger equation in region 1 and region 2. Let me do my mathematics a little faster, because we have to cover quite a bit of portion, and I think this is pure mathematics. Wherever there is a physics concept that I am trying to describe a little bit more in detail. So, I write general solution. Now, at this particular point, see, remember, in both these cases, if I write my Schrodinger equation, this was my Schrodinger equation, both in region 1 and 2, this is positive. Now, I had just now mentioned in the morning that I could have written the solution in terms of phi is equal to A cos kx plus B sin kx, or in the form A e raised to the power I kx plus B e raised to the power minus I kx. This I had just mentioned in the morning. Now, in the case of bound state problem, it made no difference whether I choose this particular type of solution or whether I choose this type of solutions. Okay, I would have got exactly the same result. But in the case of free state problem, it's almost essential to write the solution in this particular part, because one of the boundary conditions that I am going to use is going to depend on this particular type of writing the wave function. So, the basic thumb rule is that whenever we have a free state problem, it's better to write the solutions in this particular part. Obviously, you have to write the solution in this particular form, let me put it like that. Okay? In the case, at least the type of problems that I am going to describe, where there is a step potential involved. Okay? And when I do the boundary condition, you will realize why it's important to write the solution in this particular form. While in the case of bound state problem, you could have written in either of the two ways. It made no difference. Okay, so what I am doing, I am writing the solutions in this particular form. And remember, because here V was equal to 0 and here V was equal to V naught, so there will be two different values of K. So, for phi 1, the value of K I am calling as K 1, of course, energy is same, okay, which will be given by this. And for region 2, there will be different value of K because the potential energy has become different, and this K value will be given by this equation. Again, if you are not happy and you are feeling that I am going fast, please substitute this equation into your original Schrodinger equation and you will get automatically the solutions to be this type. Please do it yourself. That will also give you confidence in whatever I am trying to say. Alright, now we apply boundary conditions and I have only two equations, continuity wave functions and continuity of its derivatives. Can I get rid of any other constants? Can I put my condition that wave function should be finite at plus x, x is equal to plus infinity and x is equal to minus infinity? Unfortunately, I cannot. This is something which you must understand. See, when I had put that condition that wave function should be always finite, my solution was of the form A e raised to the power alpha x, and e raised to the power alpha x or minus alpha x are exponential functions which are only growing functions or decaying functions. Okay? While e raised to the power I k 1 x is actually a sum of sine and cosine term. If you remember, e raised to the power I k x can be written cos k x 1 x plus I sine k x or whatever it is. All right. This particular exponential function with an imaginary coefficient gives you a sine or cosine term. Okay? And a sine term and a cosine term are oscillatory terms. They will never become infinite. They will always become remain finite. So, even if you go to x is equal to plus infinity or x is equal to minus infinity, I mean, this is valid for x is equal to minus infinity. If I put x is equal to minus infinity, this term will not become infinity. This term will still oscillate between plus 1 and minus 1 or whatever it is. Cosine term will oscillate between plus 1 and minus 1. Cosine term will also oscillate between plus 1 and minus 1. So, irrespective of whatever value of x you choose, these equations are never going to become infinite. Similarly, they are not going to become infinite. Therefore, it will not be possible for me to get rid of these constants by the logic which I used earlier in a particle in a finite box. Is there any other way of doing it? There is another way of doing it. If I give a physical meaning of these two terms, This is what I want to emphasize. What I want to insist, let me first make a statement, then I will explain to you. I insist that this particular part of the wave function gives me a traveling wave which moves in plus x direction. This particular part of the wave function gives me a traveling wave which is moving in minus x direction. This particular part of the wave function gives me a wave which is moving in plus x direction. This particular part of the wave function gives me a wave which is traveling in minus x direction. Alright, how? Remember, just by looking x term, I cannot say in which direction does it move. But remember, it has to be multiplied by a time dependent term. And a time dependent term is always of the form e raised to power minus I e t by h cross. Remember, I have been insisting this thing right from the time when we are talking about the Schrodinger equation. Implied in this Schrodinger equation is that there is a time dependent term which is negative in sign, e raised to power minus I e t by h cross. Alright, and I have said earlier that the direction of the motion of the wave depends on the relative sign of x and t. Okay, because here this particular thing is having a positive sign and time dependent term has a negative time. Therefore, in order that when time increases, x has to increase in order to make the phase or the displacement same. Therefore, this represents a wave moving in plus x direction. This represents a wave moving in minus x direction. Of course, as a thumb rule, the advantage of taking negative time dependent term was that just by looking at the sign, if this is a plus sign, you can always say that this wave moves in plus x direction, this wave moves in minus x direction. Similarly, using exactly the same orbital logic, I can say this wave moves in plus x direction, this wave moves in minus x direction. So, if I look at this particular thing, I write a solution of this equation which consists of two terms. One represents a wave which is going in this direction, another represents a wave which is going in this direction. Similarly, when I write the solution in this region too, one particular solution represents a wave moving in this particular direction, another solution represents a wave which is moving in minus x direction. Take the analogy with normal waves. Whenever there is a change in medium, I can expect some reflection. So, though my original particle is coming in this particular direction, because there is a change in medium, there is a change in potential energy, there is a possibility that this electron may go back, or this particular particle, I have not said it is an electron, it could be any particle, this particular particle goes back. But once the particle has crossed, if at all the particle has crossed to this region, has gone to positive values of x, my problem does not state that this particular particle encounters any further change of potential or any other step potential. So, after that, this particular particle can never come back. Because now there is no change in the medium. This particular particle has moved from one medium to another medium. Okay, in this particular medium, this particular particle has to keep on traveling to plus infinity direction. There is no way that this particular particle will be able to revert its direction. It could have reverted its direction had it seen a change in the medium, or for that matter, a change in potential energy, which does not happen. Therefore, though it is possible for a wave to go and come back in this particular direction, so if you are in negative values of x, you may find electron going this particular direction, which might have resulted as a result of reflection from here. But when particle has crossed this particular region, there is no way that this particular particle is going to come back. So, for positive values of x, it means in region 2, there is no way that I will be able to get a particle traveling in minus x direction. So, that particular part of the wave function, which represents a wave traveling in minus x direction, cannot exist in region 2. Therefore, this particular part thing, I will make 0. It means I will put d is equal to 0. That's what is the important thing that I am going to mention in this particular case. So, my wave function becomes this way. Physical interpretation of different components yield d is equal to 0. Then I apply boundary condition. You apply the wave functions to be same at x is equal to 0. You apply their derivatives to be same. This is the wave functions to be same. This is derivative to be same. You just get these things. Remember, we have only two equations. We have three constants. One constant we got rid of. One constant I can never get rid of, okay? We have just enough number of constants, and therefore, there is no further condition which is being put here to quantize the energy. The particle could have all possible values of energies. Now, you just solve these equations. This is a plus b is equal to c, a minus b is equal to this thing. So, you can write, take some, add them and subtract them. You will get the values of a and b. You can find out what is c upon a and what is b upon a. that will give you what is the probability that the particle gets reflected or what is the probability that particle gets transmitted. And eventually, as I say, these particular problems are more interesting when you do not have one particle, but you have number of particles which are coming, it is a beam of particles coming, so you can find out what is the reflection coefficient and what is the transmission coefficient. Comments, we have one less number of equations than bound state. Remember, when we did a bound state problem, we could get rid of two constants, one on this side, negative side, one on the positive side. Here we could get rid of only one constant. So you have one less number of equations, hence no quantization of energy, all energies are allowed. Strictly speaking, non-normalizable wave function that I have mentioned even earlier. These are interesting from the point of view of scattering of particles. We can evaluate transmission coefficient and reflection coefficient. Here there is also one of the important point which I must just mention. Then I will go to another case, another type of the problem. We have to look at the relative probability of finding the particle in different parts of the beam. Probability is different from the number of particles crossing, which I must mention. Let me just sort of explain this particular part a little bit. So let us suppose I am interested in finding what is the probability of finding the particle, or let me put it like that, let me talk because in terms of beam, because that's a little more easily understandable. So you have, let's say, beam of particle, you do not have just one particle. Of course, we solve one particle equation. I assume that there is only one particle and then find out the wave function and assume that these particles do not interact, like the answer which I was trying to give you in today's morning. Okay, and therefore, assume that all the particles have the same wave function. All right. Now, let us suppose this is a small region, let us say x and x plus dx. And within a given time, I want to find out how many number of particles are there. So, I can calculate what is the probability of finding the particle. Now, for example, if the particle is entering from here and going with a very large velocity, then this particle enters and remains, spends very little time in this particular region and goes out. Now, let us suppose there are same number of particles which are coming, but they are coming with smaller speed. If they come with smaller speed, they will spend more time here before they come out. If they are coming out with small speed, you will find out that the probability of finding the particle gets enhanced because you are seeing a larger number of particles which are being there. Okay? Now, when I am defining transmission coefficient and reflection coefficient, I define them in terms of how many number of particles cross a particular region. And that particular crossing will also depend on what are their velocities. It will not just depend on probability of finding it. Let's say B upon A square gives, you see, this particular part of phi 1 had two parts, which was A e raised to power I kx, k1x, plus B e raised to power minus I k1x. All right, this represents a wave moving in plus x direction. This represents a wave which is moving in minus x direction. That's what we have discussed. Now, if I take complex conjugate of this and multiply by this, I will get A square. Now, this A square is going to be proportional. Okay, remember, we have not normalized. It's going to be proportional to the probability of finding the particle beam which is going in plus x direction. While B square, I take complex conjugate of this, so it becomes plus I kx, multiply by this, this exponential term goes away, so this becomes b square. B square is going to be proportional to the probability of finding a particle in the reflected beam. This represents the reflected beam. This represents the incident beam. So, b upon a square ratio gives me the relative ratio of the probability of reflection. Okay. Similarly, c upon a square ratio gives me the probability of finding a particle reflected beam, relative probability of finding particle reflected beam. Here, when the particle gets reflected, it moves with the same velocity. But on the other hand, when particle goes into region 2, its velocity goes down. Okay? So, for the given region, a larger number of particles could exist, while C upon A square gives me only the probability. If I have to calculate the transmission coefficient, I must multiply by their individual velocities to find how many of them actually cross a given region. So, as far as reflection coefficient is concerned, it will give you B upon A square, which you just put those numbers. When put transmission coefficient, it will be multiplied by V2 by V1, because this is only relative probability, and this particular thing has to take care in order to find out how many particles actually cross this particular thing. Whenever we are comparing things in two different regions, then you have to, where the velocities are different, then velocities have to be taken care. Here also should have been V1 upon V1, but because V1s are same, so then they get cancelled out. Now you can show very easily that reflection coefficient plus transmission coefficient is equal to 1. Now, that this particular thing can also be interpreted from the value of momentum eigenvalues. We have talked about eigenvalues. If I apply momentum operator to A sine kx, you find out that this particular sine kx is not an eigenfunction. That's the reason I did not want to represent this in terms of sine kx, because in that case I will not be able to interpret this in terms of wave moving in plus x direction and minus x direction, which is important because we are interested in reflection coefficient and also we are interested in using this to get rid of one constant. Therefore, I decided not to use sine kx term because sine kx does not turn out to be a momentum eigenvalues of momentum operator. On the other hand, if I apply momentum operator to this particular thing, you can see that this is just this thing which can be written as h cross k times this. So you can say px, when I apply on this particular function, I get a constant times the same function. So this a raised to power I kx is an eigenfunction of momentum operator with an eigenvalue of h cross k. Hence, this is an eigenfunction of the momentum operator with eigenvalue of h cross k. Now, if I write the solution in this particular form, a I raised to power kx plus b raised to power minus I kx, you realize this is also an eigenfunction with an eigenvalue of minus h cross k. This is also an eigenfunction which is with eigenvalue h cross k. When I write these two things, this is a linear combination of two eigenfunctions, and therefore probability that you will get a particular particle with an eigenvalue h cross k is proportional to a square, coefficient square. Probability that you find the particle with eigenvalue of minus h cross k will be proportional to b square, which gives me exactly the same thing that I have discussed earlier. Now, let's just quickly go through the second step potential. Now, if we assume that E is less than V naught, so a particle approaches again from the left hand side, but now it's approaching with a energy less than V naught. Now, classically, in this particular case, the particle would have always gone back, because as I said, a particle classically could not have crossed to region x greater than 0, because then its kinetic energy will be negative. We still call it a free state wave function, even though there are certain values of x to which this particular particle could not exist classically, okay? But nevertheless, the physical extent of this particle is infinite. It exists from minus infinity to 0, which is the infinite extent. So this is still a free state problem. This is not a bound state problem, all right? Now, we try to work out exactly the same thing, and just let's see. I will just highlight the difference in the solutions that I have used from the earlier case. Now, thing is that in region 2, I will write the solution in this particular form, not in terms of ikx and minus ikx, because my v naught is larger than e, just like in particle in a finite box. Once I do this thing, now these are no longer sinusoidally varying function. I can apply that particular boundary condition that wave function must remain finite. When I say wave function remains finite, it means it cannot blow at x is equal to infinity to infinite value, which this term would have done. So I force this particular term to be 0 and therefore put c equal to 0. So but remember, I could get rid of only one constant still, okay? But the physical argument that I have used is different here. In the earlier case, I had used the physical argument that there cannot be any wave traveling in minus x direction. Here I have used the condition that my wave function has to remain finite. Again, apply boundary conditions, continuity of wave functions, continuity of their derivatives. Just take reflection coefficient, and in this case, you will find reflection coefficient to be equal to 1. So, you will really realize that all the particles actually come back, they all get reflected back. But nevertheless, there is a finite probability of finding a particle in the classically forbidden region, just like a skin depth. Particle may penetrate to some extent in the classically forbidden region and may then eventually get reflected back. Reflection coefficient is 1, so all particles eventually get reflected. Still, there is a finite probability for finding particle in classically forbidden region. Now, this gives you one very interesting possibility. See, I had just now said that there is a finite probability of finding the particle in the classically forbidden region. Now, suppose I make this thing very, very small, and I have something like this, okay? In this particular region, this is classically forbidden region, but there is a finite probability of finding the particle here. Is it possible that the particle crosses this region? Once it crosses this particular region, then in principle, again, the particle can exist, because now its energy is greater than V naught, and this is no longer classically forbidden region, okay? Now, if in principle, there should be a possibility, which is something like this, and this is what I want to just quickly go through. I will not give the complete mathematics. Would like to say that this possibility exists, that in principle, this particular particle could eventually be found in this particular region, okay, which we call a phenomenon of tunneling, as probably all of you would have heard. Now, this essentially, if you look from the pure nature, can think that if you make a region very thin enough, if you take a particular opaque material and make it extremely thin, okay, it will always transmit some light. It's almost of this type that you have made this particular thing thin enough so that you can find out always some particles which will be able to penetrate through. This is what is called tunneling, and you know there are tunnel diodes, etc. There are many tunneling phenomenon. I think Professor Ghosh may talk about, you know, some superconducting tunneling. They are all based on this particular idea. This, I said, phenomenon can be understood on the basis of wave theory. If the classically forbidden region is of small width, can particle pass through to the other side? This is what I said is a tunneling phenomenon. So I have considered this particular thing. It's exactly similar type of problem. Remember, this is exactly the well that we had talked about earlier, except that now it's on the other side. So you see the problem which I solved, just the first problem today, between x is equal to 0 and L, the well was on the other side. Now it has gone to V is equal to V naught. Except that, you know, also the origin of potential energy was somewhat different, but otherwise exactly the same problem. But this is a free state problem that I am looking. A particle is coming from here with a finite amount of energy. Okay, the shape is somewhat like the earlier problem. I will divide into region 1, region 2, region 3 as before. I will write the wave function and I will go rather quickly because I do not want to go into the particle approaches from left with E less than V naught. General solution, we agree this has to be of this form. In region 2, it has to be this form, because this is a classically forbidden region. Region 3 has to be again in this particular form. Okay. Here, of course, K has to be same because V naught is same in region 1 and region 3. Is there any coefficient 0? This coefficient cannot be 0, C or D, because this is valid only between 0 and L, and between 0 and L, neither this term nor that term becomes infinite. Okay. This term could have become infinite. This term could have become infinite had this been valid at x is equal to plus infinity. This term would have become infinite had this term would have been valid at x is equal to minus infinity. This, none of the two is the case. Okay, this term is valid only between 0 and L. Therefore, these terms always remain finite. Therefore, I cannot get rid of these constants. Only thing that we can get rid of is this constant, because once the particle has crossed to region 3, in that case, you cannot find a particle which is moving in minus x direction. Therefore, this particular particle, this coefficient becomes 0. I hope the logic is becoming clear of how we are applying different boundary conditions. These are my boundary conditions which I will get. Now, I will match. This one constant is 0, then match, there are two regions now, two boundaries. So, I match their wave functions, I match their derivatives, I get four terms, I express everything in terms of A. Then actually you can do some calculation which is not a trivial calculation. You can find out 1 upon T, which is the inverse of transmission coefficient, A upon F square. You remember, this represents the incident beam, this represents the reflected beam in region 1, this represents the transmitted beam. So, F upon A square. Remember, velocities are same in region 1 and region 3. So, F upon A square will represent the transmission coefficient from region 1 to region 3, or represent tunneling current. So, what I have calculated, or rather what I have given here, is A upon F, and that value turns out to be equal to this. So, this is a standard tunneling phenomenon. I will stop here. We can take a few questions. MES Pillay is...
In finite potential well, if the particle is considered as wave,
yes,
then every time the particle hits the wall,
yeah,
there should be loss of energy due to transmission and reflection.
No, see,
because wave, when incident on a surface, there will be three phenomena: transmission, reflection and absorption.
Basically, I would say that the entire wave function represents that particular particle. Okay, my impression is the way when you start talking like this, you are still insisting that your particle is a localized entity which has to be very, very tiny, which is going to go and hit the wall. Okay, I say that this picture, we have to get rid of that picture. Particle is no longer localized. The entire wave packet, entire wave which I am writing, entire wave function represents that particle. And its physical interpretation is only that there is a probability of finding the particle. Okay, we are not talking of anything else other than that. Okay, I mean, that's what is difficulty definitely at first year level, because we are so used to thinking of a particle as a tiny particle which has to go and hit the wall, and therefore, you know, this particular particle has to be here, it must go here and come here and then hit the wall. Okay, I mean, things that those concepts are not, don't exist for a quantum mechanical particle. This wave represents the particle itself. Okay, so entire particle is represented by this particular wave, and this particular wave has to be interpreted as how, what is the probability of localizing a particular particle in a given region. That's all I can say, nothing more.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome. PSC College of Technology.
Sir, we are dealing with optical materials. We always have, by theory, the sum of absorption, reflection and the transmission is equal to 1.
That's right. You are 100% right that this particular thing should be always true. But remember, when we are talking of reflection coefficient, transmission coefficient, we are talking of free state problem. See, remember there is a difference between free state problem and the bound state problem. Okay, the question that you have asked is perfectly valid when we are talking of free state problem, the type of the problem which I did in the later part, okay, not the first part. Now, there when I am seeing a particular beam of particle is coming, okay, if I take reflection coefficient plus transmission coefficient, that does turn out to be equal to 1. Similarly, in the case of tunneling also, if you find out what is the reflection coefficient and what is the transmission coefficient, that has to turn out to be equal to 1. See, there cannot be loss of particles. Okay, is there a beam of particle, the number of particles have to be conserved. So, transmission coefficient plus reflection coefficient always have to be turned out to be same and to be equal to 1. Okay, there is absolutely no ambiguity. What you have said is a perfectly correct statement.
Okay, sir, does it mean that the absorption is also inclusive in this transmission, sir?
No, see, in this case, we are not considering any absorption because we are talking of quantum mechanical particles and these wells are somewhere where particles cannot be absorbed. So, it's not like that optical wave where, you know, you can, some photons can be absorbed and can give rise to some sort of excitation. So, I'm assuming that none of those processes are possible in which these particles could be absorbed. See, these particles are sort of a massive particle. You can imagine always a system, you know, in a relativistic system when the particles could get absorbed, can disappear. But I do not expect these things to happen in these cases. At least, these equations are not valid for those relativistic cases.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Welcome. Goa College of Engineering.
My question is related to the tutorial session that we had yesterday on quantum mechanics.
Yes.
And there we discussed the application of this wave particle duality as applicable to Bose magnetization condition.
That's right, yeah.
So my question is, since an electron is said to be in stationary orbit because it's not supposed to lose energy.
Yeah.
My question is, when a stationary wave is formed, we require an incident and a reflected wave so that a stationary wave pattern is formed.
That's
how do we interpret it? Will you please elaborate in that context, sir?
Okay. The basic issue is something like this. See, that particular problem which was given was the way it appears de Broglie thought of the issue. Okay. It's very, very difficult to imagine a stationary wave in a circular string. All right. So, in fact, normally in the normal lectures, I always want to avoid this particular thing. But nevertheless, I do want to mention because this particular thing has a historical impact. Let me put it like something like this. Generally, for example, you take a vibration of a string, okay, you find only those type of frequencies possible in that particular string which satisfy certain boundary condition and which gives you a stationary wave. Okay, all other frequencies will not sort of exist in that particular string. It's like a musical instrument. If you are trying to play a violin or want to play sitar, okay, so there is only certain frequencies which satisfy certain boundary conditions. Now, remember, let me just complete it. Now, Bohr's model is strictly speaking not correct. Okay, we cannot talk of Bohr orbit these days with quantum mechanical idea. But at that time of de Broglie, Bohr's model was in fashion. And what he was thinking, what is so surprising that only these particular orbits are possible and no other orbits are possible. Okay, so he thought that why not imply a condition of a stationary wave, maybe some stationary wave is propagating inside, and that is the reason these are the only orbits which are possible. All right, so using that particular concept, he obtained this de Broglie relationship and then applied it. So it is more of historical importance rather than talking of more physical aspect, because concept of Bohr orbit itself is not correct. Yes, please go ahead.
But how to reach out to the students while explaining this? They will ask the question that how stationary waves are formed there.
Exactly the same way the way I have described. This is the way I would like to answer to the question. See, this is only of historical impact. This is the way de Broglie obtained this particular thing. I know that this particular thing I cannot talk. I cannot talk of a well-defined orbit. I can only talk about wave function in today's world. But historically, if you look, that is the way de Broglie found it out. Because that's the way he convinced himself that this is the way probably the particle should have a wavelength. So, that's the way I will take and I will stop here. Yes, you have another question.
So, can we go back to the slide where we had this finite potential well solution to the three regions? While selecting the solutions for the three different regions,
that's right.
Is there a specific condition that we have to adopt or we can generalizedly take any solution for the three regions?
See, thing is that as I have mentioned in the morning today, whenever you are getting equation of the form d2y dx square is equal to a constant times y, the solution can be obtained by just looking into it. Of course, I am not very sure about whether mathematicians have a rigorous way of deriving it. And so long I have my two constants and it is a second order equation, this is the general solution. All right. So, all these equations of the type d2y dx square is equal to a constant times y. Okay, I can write the solution depending upon whether this constant k is positive or negative. Okay. If it is positive, the solution is in the exponential form. Okay. If it is negative, then it's in the form of sine and cosine. So just by looking at that equation, I can find out the solution.
Okay, so there is no specific rules by which these solutions have to be taken.
At least I do not know. I mean, probably mathematicians would have a way of doing it. I'm not sure about it.
And for the barrier potential,
yes.
If we look at the tunneling phenomena of an electron crossing over into the forbidden region,
yeah, that's right.
To go into a towards the third region,
yes.
The electron not only does has to have that V0, it also has to travel the distance L.
Yeah.
So what would that term V0 into L give me?
No. See, the thing is that, when we are talking of a particle going from one region to another region and passing through a classically forbidden region, again, I am insisting on a localized picture of the particle. Okay. It means, again, I am thinking of my ideas are classical. Okay. Now, what is happening? Let me put that, not VL, I think V0 square L has some significance because this will actually determine how much is the tunneling, etc. Okay. That's a different issue. But if your question is about that, how the electron passes from that region, okay, if at all I want to perform an experiment and want to be very sure that my particle is in the classically forbidden region and also want to measure its kinetic energy to find out that it's negative, I will never be able to perform this experiment. My uncertainty principle protects. That's what I was trying to tell you, that uncertainty principle protects wave particle duality. Whenever I have this uncomfortable question, I can always raise my hands, uncertainty principle. I cannot answer this question. Whenever I try to do this thing, okay, I'll land into a problem, I'll always perturb the experiment enough. Okay, then I will either not be sure that my particle is in the classically forbidden region, or I will not be sure about the measurement of kinetic energy. Just like I will never be able to perform the experiment whether the particle goes from this slit or it goes from this slit.
So, is that why we take an I term in the first and the third region, e raised to I?
No. We take I because I want to assign a direction to the wave function. That's only possible when we have solution of e raised power I kx. Because I want to say that there is no wave which is traveling in minus x direction. So, region why I am putting e raised power I kx and minus I kx, because I want to interpret them in the form of a traveling wave which is moving in plus x direction and minus x direction. And this is absolutely essential whenever I am talking of free state solutions. In a bound state problem, it does not matter. All right, I think I will just close the discussion there.